Hi.
Hi.
So you just came back from Telluride.
Yeah.
Was did you watch the film? Do you watch a film with an audience when you go to a festival?
I couldn't bear to. I mean, I watched the beginning to make sure the projection was right, and I came in towards the end because I wanted to hear the reaction to the end of the film, but it was too nervous making to sit through the whole thing.
Have you watched it with test screening audiences?
Oh, yes. Or? I've watched it with several audiences. And
so do you have any, because we've talked to actually the writers and two of the actors, and everybody's kind of said there's really no cues in the film for them to figure out how the film is playing as it goes along. Do you have any?
Well, the sense you get is, I mean, there's very little harumphing or rustling or coughing, and people seem to be very kind of fixed on the screen. Nobody really tends to leave. And then the big, you know, there are actually a few chuckles in the film. Mm-hmm. You know, the real cue at the end is you just hear a lot of sobbing and sniffling and a lot of this stuff under the glasses, and so it does. When it gets to people, it hits them pretty hard.
And so you felt good at the end of this.
It was an unforgettably wonderful weekend. Yeah.
And you hadn't been to Telluride before.
Never been to Telluride, so it was like it was a dream to go to Telluride, and it was, you know, a dream to get the chance to make this movie. So I was like a very happy camper up there, and I just love the mountains. And as a bonus, it's so beautiful up there. It seems like it's fake or something. It's almost like your mind can't actually grasp how beautiful it is.
Yeah. So how did you get to make this movie?
Well, you know, I read the book the week it was published, and it made me cry. Couldn't stop thinking about it. It's got this, a lot of Ishiguro's books have this quality where they just kind of burrow into your subconscious or your mind in a way, and you can't stop thinking about them.
And you read it because it was Ishiguro,
I'm just a fan. No, I read everything he's written. I mean, I started with Remains of the Day, then I went backwards, and then would read everything that comes out afterwards. I'm just a fan. And I was so interested in it, I read it again, because I wanted to read it with the knowledge of certain secrets and mysteries that were revealed. And that's the second time is when I started thinking that possibly this could be a film. And I heard through the grapevine that Searchlight was involved, and I had made 1 hour photo with Searchlight. So I called Peter Rice, and he said, well, sadly, another director's already attached. And I was very disappointed, extremely disappointed, but disappointment is kind of the currency of this business. So I moved on, and then I got involved in another big Hollywood film that was not a very good experience for me. And so I had to make the very, very difficult decision of leaving that film just before it started shooting, which was traumatic. I was kind of curled up in a fetal position. It was not an easy decision to make. And
because you were giving up your art or piece, or because you were
because I had spent 9 months of my life, much of it away from my family, working on this thing that I believed in, and we just could never all get on the same page about it. Mm-hmm. And there's also an unwritten sense, an unwritten rule maybe, that a director's not allowed to leave. It's almost like the army. Once you sign up, you got to follow through. And I felt it was best for them that they found a director to, you know, make the film that they wanted to see. But it was very, very hard. To not bring something to fruition that you'd work that hard on. And the first call I got from someone in the business, who I also consider a friend, was Peter. And he said, I know how you must feel, but I think from what I've heard, you've made the right decision. And don't worry, you'll work again, because in your mind you go, okay, I've just blackmailed myself for life, and how am I going to support my family, you know? And about 2 weeks later, it was a very generous phone call, and about 2 weeks later he called me and he said, are you still interested in Never Let Me Go? And I said, yes, I am. And he said, well, I think that director is not going to work out, and would you be interested in meeting with Andrew McDonald and Alan Reich and Alex Garland? And I said, yes, I would. So that started that journey.
And was it kismet? Was it because I mean, it sounds like the process of making the movie into a screenplay, and it sounds like everything just kind of fell together so that everybody really fit.
There was a bit of struggling here and there, but in a kind of good creative way. But there was definitely a sense that there was wind in the sails of this, and that the right people had come together for the right reasons. It was the opposite of that other experience I had where, I mean, all a director really wants is for their idea of the movie to be believed in and supported. And, you know, I was asked to take part in a collaborative experience. Andrew Alon and Alex had been developing this project for about 2 years. Mm-hmm. And they had very clear, firm ideas about what they thought, what was important about it, and what they felt the emphasis of it should be. Mm-hmm. So they didn't want a director to come in and just say, "See you guys, I'm going to go make the movie." They needed somebody that was going to be willing to work with them. But when I met these guys, they're so smart. So, you know, sensitive, smart guys who mm-hmm. whose only intention was to make the best and most beautiful thing. There's no ulterior motives. Mm-hmm. And they had good ideas, and they seemed to like my idea of the movie. And I think they felt that that they wanted someone to bring a visual component to it that was going to make these very disturbing truths maybe not more palatable just for the sake of making them palatable, mm-hmm. but because there's something about the way Kazuo writes that makes it go down easy, and that's quite beautiful. Mm-hmm. So I think that was part of the reason I was they selected me. But I think people underestimate how important it is for a film to be beautifully produced. Mm-hmm. People think of producers as the bad guys sometimes, or it's a pejorative almost. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I had worked in England several times, and I had a knowledge of England, but I never made a feature film in England. Mm. And Alon and Andrew facilitated my idea of the movie and produced the film creatively mm-hmm. to help me do what they hired me to do, you know? And so that's what made it such a pleasant experience. But we just kind of passively agreed to agree on things, all four of us. Mm-hmm. And not move forward until all four of us felt we'd arrived at the right solution mm. to an individual problem. And when we couldn't arrive at it, sometimes Kazuo would be the mediator. We'd call him up and say, "Well, what do you think about this?" You know, mm-hmm. and he was always available to us in that way.
So was the palette for this film obvious to you, or was it hard work to figure out
the color palette?
The color palette and the visual, the locations you chose.
Well, I mean, I had a pretty clear idea of what I wanted the tone of the film to be, and I wanted to try to create, see if I could create like a visual grammar that would be approximate an analog to Ishiguro's writing style. And mm-hmm. for me, the key to that was, ironically, maybe a Japanese sensibility in his writing. Because I knew what's interesting about the book is it's this kind of really fascinating hybrid between a Japanese sensibility and an English sensibility, mm-hmm. and that gets to issues of why they don't run, which is a question that comes up, which you could talk about later. But I thought that everything I was going to be pointing the camera at was going to be English by mm-hmm. nature. It was going to be English people and English places and English details and English salt shakers. And so if I could come up with my sense of a Japanese sensibility for the framing of the film, for how mm-hmm. to tell the story, that might approximate that hybrid that's so interesting about the book. So I actually did a lot of research on Japanese concepts and Japanese mm-hmm. art and aesthetics, and I met with a professor of Japanese aesthetics mm-hmm. in London and watched a lot of Japanese cinema. Ishiguro mentioned that he was more influenced by Japanese cinema of the 50s and 60s than he was by other writers. Mm-hmm. And one filmmaker that he mentioned was that I wasn't familiar with was Mikio Narusa, mm. whose films are really exquisite. And it was just a bonus also because I was just exposed to this body of work that I wasn't familiar with. And I really recommend people seek out his films, particularly mm-hmm. a film called When a Woman Ascends the Stair. Great, great film. But so I tried to suffuse the film with my, you know, sense, my American suburban guy's sensibility of what might feel Japanese.
And British.
Huh?
And British, and not.
Well, it's British.
Why
I'm saying it's innately British because yeah. everything we're pointing at the camera was British. So I tried to bring that quality to it.
And was the casting smooth and easy for you, or was it?
Well, we had a hard time finding Kathy. We had a hard time finding the perfect actress for Kathy, and we didn't feel like we can cast anyone else till we had her. Uh-huh. And we were actually at something of a crossroads where we had to shoot the film by a certain date because we needed to schedule it so that a certain chunk of it happened during half term in England, so we'd have access to children, so they wouldn't mm-hmm. be in school. There were scenes with 150 children.
Right.
And so we kind of had a cutoff and when we had a start, and we hadn't found our Kathy. And Peter Rice was at Sundance, and he saw an education. And he sent me a four-word email that said, "Hire the genius Mulligan." And later I asked him, why was it such a terse email? He said, because I was still in the movie. He hadn't even gotten through the whole movie, and he knew that she was the one. So we went to New York and met Carrie, and that was fated, it seemed. She just read the voiceover to camera, which wasn't even something we were going to film, and we knew that she was it. And then because of that, Kira's agent called us and said, have you cast the role of Ruth? Because Kira's really interested in working with Carrie. So that's how we got Keira Knightley in our film. And then for me, Andrew was always the one to beat, because I had seen a film that called Boy A.
The Great Boy A. And barely released by the Weinstein Company, unfortunately.
What I was going to say was that his performance in that film is absolutely as astonishing as Carrie's was in An Education, but it wasn't as celebrated because the film wasn't as widely seen. But I also recommend that film. Sort of great a perfect little movie. So I don't think we could have found three more amazing young actors.
So was there any consideration about commercial viability of the actors in a situation? I mean, often if you make, you're funding a movie through a couple different countries and everything, that everybody's kind of figuring out how much these people are worth, quote unquote.
Well, that's what's great about Peter Rice at the time. I mean, he's not running Searchlight anymore, and I should mention that, you know, it's Nancy Utley and Steve Galula are running the company beautifully now, and they have the same sense of daring. But I'm just keep mentioning Peter because he was running it at the time the film was greenlit. I mean, his mantra was always cast the most perfect and greatest actor for the role. And he, amazingly, you know, I'm sure he's got one eye on the sense of how their box office appeal, but there's never any sort of push for the bigger name. There's the push for the right actor, which is the smart way to make movies. You know, and he certainly, they've all had a great track record doing it that way, so.
And he picks interesting directors, or they've always been open to interesting directors over there.
Yeah, I think he picks projects that have, by nature, have something about them that'll gets talked about, so they can rise up above this sort of mass of tsunami of films that come out every year, you know.
So, of course, is in some level a rude question. Why don't you work more?
A rude question?
I don't know if it's a rude question, but why are we only seeing, you know, why has it been so long between films,
It's not this sort of overly picky kind of selective, you know, thing. I mean,
it's kind of the mystery that's around you, you know.
But, I mean, I think I'm somewhat selective. I try to wait for things of quality. If you someone gives you an opportunity to direct an adaptation of a novel by Kazuo Ishiguro, this is a quality thing. So I want to make a lot of movies, and I started a project with Tom Hanks called A Cold Case, based on this brilliant nonfiction book by Philip Gurevich. And we were deep into pre-production on that film, and a script by Eric Roth. I mean, it's a fantastic project. And we came up against this unforeseen life rights problem that torpedoed that. Then I got involved in A Million Little Pieces, the James Fry book. And I'm doing a location scout in Milwaukee, deep into the pre-production on that movie, and I get a call, have you seen The Smoking Gun?
God.
I'm like, what's The Smoking Gun? And, you know, then the book was sort of torpedoed as a false memoir, and that project canceled.
That book almost like made to be a film. It was practically a screenplay.
Oh, it was a great
reading it.
Yeah, it was a great adaptation, and it did seem a little too good to be true. The beautiful structure of that story was like a fairy tale. So that, you know, and each of these were like 6, 7, 8, 9 months of work. You know, then I got involved in The Wolfman, and we talked about that earlier. So it's a really strange journey. However, having not made any movies, I made a lot of amazing things happen in my life. I got married. I had 2 children. I wrote several screenplays. I made all those Apple iPod silhouette commercials, which was like kept me busy each year, and they're very fun to do and really iconic idea of the agencies. I was really busy, and it just didn't result in films. I'm not sure why that happened, but maybe I got to spend a lot more time with my kids, and I don't really regret anything, but, you know, this all worked out fine.
So all things considered, we could expect a film a year from you for the next 10 years?
I don't know about that, but it's not going to be 8 years, I don't think. I mean, I hope I'll get something going soon.
Well, you have that kind of Kubrickian mystery about you where, you know, he's very selective, he makes his choices. But this movie is so different than 1 Hour Photo that, I mean, you can feel the hand on the rudder, but it's not, I mean, it's a different, such a different animal.
Well, I mean, I ultimately hope they'll all be kind of different. I mean, yeah. That's part of the thing I love about filmmaking is, here's a problem. What's the aesthetic solution to the problem? You know, and this was kind of daunting. This was a very delicate. There weren't any real templates for this movie tonally. There's not a lot of subtle sci-fi like this that's so deeply emotional. I mean, there's like Truffaut's Fahrenheit 451 is this kind of subtle sci-fi, and Godard's Alphaville, but that's a little more arch, that film. So I felt a little, we all felt a little out on a limb with this one, because we couldn't fall back on, oh, well, when this is how you do this type of film. There was no, but I mean, I'd like to.
They're coming for him.
Yeah, I mean, wait a second, maybe. It's up to you. I don't know how it sounds to you. I lost my train of thought.
Okay, sorry.
No, it's their fault.
Damn that garbage truck.
Those are very stylish shoes.
Thank you. I made them myself. I don't know. I bought them myself.
Do I have my water here?
Yes. So do you see your? Okay, I'm going to start again with that whole thing, even though it'll still be on film. Everybody has said sci-fi. The writers have both said sci-fi. The actors kind of said sci-fi. You said sci-fi. Sci-fi somehow to me is like the last thing that this film is. It doesn't. I mean, I guess the premise is somewhat, but
yeah, I wasn't making a sci-fi film. I was making a love story.
Yeah.
And anytime early in the design process, kind of things that came up that seemed like overt sci-fi tropes, futuristic buildings or gadgets or things, it just felt wrong.
Mm-hmm.
It felt beside the point. I mean, I think the science fiction is a metaphor. It's like a delivery system for these larger themes about how do we come to terms with the fact of our mortality, and how do we, when we bring that knowledge that we're here for a short time, when we bring that to the front of our minds, how do we spend our time, and what's the best use of our time, and what do we decide is important and not important, and how do we come to the end of our lives and not regret the way we lived it? You know, that's what the film's about, and no one's immune from those themes. Everyone, sadly, is going to die.
Though it seems that in this film, Kathy seems to be almost the only one who pursues that, who ultimately has a besides, obviously, they're conscious of what's going to happen, but Kathy actually chooses to become a carer, which gives her whatever satisfaction that gives her. But everybody else seems to just kind of be in stasis, almost just waiting,
I would argue with you about that. I mean, I feel like one of the things is like the three main characters, it's about how they come to terms with that fact of their mortality. And Tommy tries to scheme a way around it. And Ruth kind of deals from a place of fear. She doesn't want to be alone, and she's afraid of it. Tommy's going to scheme around it. The thing that I find so moving about Kathy is she comes to this place of acceptance about it. That's very graceful, you know. And in my research on all that Japanese stuff, I came across this really beautiful concept called Yugen, which is a part of the tradition of no drama. And one of the ideas of Yugen is the joyful acceptance of the basic sadness of life. And I feel like that's where Kathy is at the end of the film, and I feel like it's a very beautiful relationship to our mortality, and I think it's one of the things that moves me. I mean, I watch the film and sometimes tear up after seeing it 500 times, literally. Because of this, I find this idea so moving.
Well, Ruth almost finds a maturity in the in the finality of it. It seems to me, it's almost like that finally is what makes her whole in a weird way, is being chopped into pieces.
Well, I think she needs to, she needs to receive some forgiveness and redemption for the terrible mistake she made early in her life, and that. Perhaps when she receives it and gives them this gift of this address, of Madame's address, so that our two lovers can attempt to seek a deferral to have more time together. I think when she's made this gesture and she senses that she's been forgiven, she can allow herself to move on.
So did you What were there things that you had to be careful about along the way? I mean, obviously, set dressing and stuff like that you were talking about before, but were there real discussions or real things that you felt you had to move to keep the balance and keep that tone?
The thing I was most concerned about was the, I wonder if I can talk about it without giving anything away, was the, I wanted you to believe that they had a chance for the deferral and that mm-hmm. when they go to ask for it, that there was a real possibility that this particular myth that arose at Hailsham was true.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, there's real no suspense in that moment. And that the modulation of that all through the film and how Madame is reacting to Tommy's drawings and this type of thing, and the whole build-up to that point, and anytime anyone referred to that notion, I was very concerned that it was a real possibility.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And Sally Hawkins' character in there seems to me like almost like a classic war protester, like somebody who came of age at Kent State in the 60s and was suddenly conscious of what was going on around her for the first time.
Yeah, I think she comes in naively, thinking this is a wonderful I mean, keeping in mind that this is an alternate society, and the whole fabric of the society is different than ours, and the idea of this sort of bioengineering and human cloning is as common as nuclear energy or electricity. So it's not. So this idea that she was coming to this place, this Hailsham campaign, where these human beings were kind of like free-range chickens rather mm-hmm. than factory farm chickens, she felt that she was taking part in something that was moral. Or as moral as one could be in the horrific conception of this
right.
alternate world, and when she saw the reality of it, she saw that it was actually perhaps far crueler, that these children were just given little glimpses of a real life,
mm-hmm.
and that there was no attention being paid to the fact that they would develop these emotions and relationships, and that's the tragedy of the film. But we were very lucky to have someone of her stature play that scene. I knew it was an important scene.
Do you think she would be more in favor of what I guess we get a sense of is the next generation of, I guess they call them battery farms in the movie? Or they mention it sounds more like The Matrix.
I don't know. I think she just must be outraged by the whole notion of the whole concept.
Mm-hmm.
But I know it's hard. I'm not necessarily going to be that articulate about the ethical issues because. They're interesting, you know, but they weren't germane at all to me in the making of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I was only interested in the character's point of view about it and the emotions that they arose in them and the conflicts that the situation arose in them. But the ethics of this stuff is just kind of dinner table stuff. It wasn't helpful to me as a filmmaker.
Well, it doesn't seem to, it's not in the movie, which I guess is part of the strength of the movie. Is that it's not really part of the discussion of the film internally.
Well, that's a bunch of I mean, Ishiguro, you know, those are a bunch of cans of worms that when you open one, you have to start describing and explaining every detail of how this society changed, and it's just not what the movie's about. I mean, Ishiguro will tell you, he was interested in making a film about young people whose lives were going to be artificially shortened for some mm-hmm. reason. And he considered the idea that they were exposed to radiation. And then one day he was listening to a radio program on stem cell research, and he went, cloning, that's... So it could have been anything. It's really... Mm-hmm. It was just a way to talk about these other things. And I'm not saying that it's not an interesting topic,
mm-hmm.
but it's not... That's such a more specific, one-dimensional mm-hmm. aspect of the movie, whereas the metaphor of it... is much more kind of engrossing idea to me.
So where will you take your satisfaction on a picture like this in the end? I mean, are you done with it now and you're at peace? Do you care about the box office? Do you care about awards? Is that...
Well, to be really sincere, what I care about is what I experienced up at Sundance, which is that people were deeply moved by it. I mean, I'm just like anyone else. If I go to a movie and pay my $10 or $12 mm-hmm. or whatever it is these days, I want to be engrossed and I want to be moved. And I want to walk away, I want to take something away from that thing that's going to affect me in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And if we, by, you know, kind of ushering this great novel to the screen, it's Ishiguro's brilliant conception,
mm-hmm.
and made this thing that moves people. And that, you know, I've had people say, I called my father because I hadn't spoken to him in 3 weeks, and I just told him I loved him, you know. And it's like, that's very moving to me. And one of the real satisfactions I take, which are a little more selfish, is that, you know, when we showed the film to Cosmo for the first time, we were pacing outside the cinema with sweaty palms, and I was like, I had butterflies in my stomach, and we came in, and he had tears in his eyes. Mm. And he loved the film, and I didn't fuck up his book. And that's a huge satisfaction. And then, you know, the box office is only an indicator of that. You work really hard on these things. You want a lot of people to see it, you know. And if it does well at the box office, it means a lot of people are seeing the film. And some of them may like it, and some of them may connect with it, and some of them may not. But it's getting seen, so.
Is there a time where you put it away and you go on to the next thing emotionally? Or?
Well, it's coming up, you know. I mean, I'm just starting this process of talking to people like you about it, and I don't really talk about it until now. So I'm enjoying discussing it, but then I guess there's a couple more film festivals, and then, mm-hmm. and then, you know, it'll be time to put it away.
Never mind.